Good morning. This is Reformation Sunday, and so as we begin this day, why we are reminded of the marvelous way that God's grace comes to us through Christ our Lord. So let us begin with a word of prayer. Gracious Lord God, we give you thanks for the marvelous gift that you give to us in Jesus our Savior. We thank you for the opportunity this day to once again renew ourselves in the midst of this ongoing pandemic, and that we have the opportunity to celebrate your goodness that comes to us through Christ. Bless us now as we worship, for we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Our special guest musician this morning is Simone Weber. Let's pause as she prepares us with a prelude. Singing May You Run and Not Be Weary, we'll sing it twice. Sustains us and all of creation. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Please use this time of silence for your own personal prayer. Faithful God, have mercy on us. We confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We turn from your loving embrace and go our own ways. We pass judgment on one another before examining ourselves. We place our own needs before those of our neighbors. We keep your gift of salvation to ourselves. Make us humble, cast away our transgressions, and turn us again to life in you, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God hears the cries of all who call out in need, and through his death and resurrection, Christ has made us his own. Hear the truth that God proclaims. Your sins are forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ. Led by the Holy Spirit, live in freedom and newness to do God's work in the world. Amen. We will sing verses 1 and 2 of the Church's One Foundation.
Church's One Foundation is Jesus Christ, her Lord.
The love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, gracious Lord, we thank you that your Holy Spirit renews the Church in every age. Pour out your Holy Spirit on your faithful people. Keep them steadfast in your word. Protect and comfort them in times of trial. Defend them against all enemies of the gospel. And bestow on the Church your saving peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We pause now for the readings for this special day, beginning in Jeremiah.
Our first lesson is a reading from the 31st chapter of Jeremiah. It tells us that the renewed covenant will not be breakable. But, like the old covenant, it will expect the people to live upright lives. To know the Lord means that one will defend the cause of the poor and needy. The renewed covenant is possible only because the Lord will forgive iniquity and not remember sin. Our hope lies in a God who forgets. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another, or say to each other, Know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more. Here ends the first lesson. And now let us recite Psalm 46, beginning with the antiphon verse.
The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold.
God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble.
Therefore we will not fear, though the earth be moved, and though the mountains shake in the depths of the sea.
Though its waters rage and foam, and though the mountains tremble with its tumult,
there is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High.
God is in the midst of the city. It shall not be shaken. God shall help it at the break of day.
The nations rage and the kingdoms shake. God speaks and the earth melts away. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold.
The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold.
Come now, regard the works of the Lord, what desolations God has brought upon the earth.
Behold the one who makes war to cease in all the world, who breaks the bow and shatters the spear, and burns the shields with fire.
Be still, then, and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth.
The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold.
The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold.
Our second lesson is a reading from the third chapter of Romans, and tells us that Paul's words stand at the heart of the preaching of Martin Luther and other Reformation leaders. No human beings make themselves right with God through works of the law. We are brought into a right relationship with God through the divine activity centered in Christ's death. This act is a gift of grace that liberates us from sin and empowers our faith in Jesus Christ. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced, and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For no human being will be justified in his sight by deeds prescribed by the law. For through the law comes the knowledge of sin. But now, apart from law, the righteousness of God has been disclosed and is attested by the law and the prophets. The righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, since all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. They are now justified by His grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a sacrifice of atonement by His blood, effective through faith. He did this to show His righteousness, because in His divine forbearance He had passed over the sins previously committed. It was to prove at the present time that He Himself is righteous and that He justifies the one who has faith in Jesus. Then what becomes of boasting? It is excluded. By what law? By that of works? No, but by the law of faith. For we hold that a person is justified by faith, apart from works, prescribed by the law. Here ends the second lesson.
Gospel according to St. John, the 8th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, "If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free." They answered him, "We are descendants of Abraham and have never been slaves to anyone. What do you mean by saying you will be made free?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not have a permanent place in the household. The son has a place there forever. So if the son makes you free, you will be free indeed." The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Some thoughts this morning from our first lesson from Jeremiah. A new covenant is being born, and this new covenant will not be breakable. Like the old covenant, it will expect that the people live upright lives. The new covenant is possible only because the Lord will forgive and not remember our sin. Someone has wronged you, betrayed you, stabbed you in the back. You're angry, fuming, ready to strangle them. Your natural response is to complain to a trusted friend about what has happened to you. Well, they will patiently listen, and then they will likely offer you this advice. You have to move on with life. Continuing to stew about this is just going to eat you up. Why don't you just forgive and forget? Oh, sure. We know how easy that is, don't we? Here's how a teacher sought to help her children catch the importance of this idea. A kindergarten teacher decided to let her class play a game. Teacher told each of the children in class to bring along a plastic bag containing a few potatoes. Each potato will be given a name of a person that child hates. So the number of potatoes that a child will put in the plastic bag will depend upon the number of persons that he or she hates. So when the day came, each child brought some potatoes with the name of the people that they felt that strongly about in terms of hating. Some had two, some had three, some had as much as five. The teacher then told the children to carry with them the potatoes in the plastic bag wherever they went for a week. Day after day passed, the children started to complain about the unpleasant smell of the potatoes that they were carrying. Besides, those having five potatoes had to carry heavier bags. After the week, the children were relieved because the teacher ended the game. And she asked, "How did you feel while you were carrying the potatoes with you for a week?" Children let out their frustrations and started complaining of the trouble that they had to go through having to carry this heavy bag of potatoes wherever they went. The teacher told them that there was a hidden meaning behind the game. She said, "That's exactly the situation when you carry around hatred in your heart for somebody else. The stench of that hatred will contaminate your heart and you will carry it with you wherever you go. If you cannot tolerate the smell of the potatoes for just 1 week, can you imagine what it's like to have the stench of hatred in your heart for longer than that?" Forgive and forget. Ask someone at the coffee shop or at the office water cooler what forgiveness means, and this is likely what they might tell you. To forgive means to forget about the wrong that has been done to you. To forgive means to stop remembering that hurt or the injustice and to put it behind you. To forgive means to move on with your life and live as if the hurt had never happened. People who offer such advice probably think that we're being helpful, but we are mistaken. To think that forgiving is forgetting distorts the true nature of forgiveness. It trivializes the hurt that it is meant to heal. It deprives forgiveness of its redeeming power. We might think that we are helpful when we tell someone to forgive and forget, but in truth, we are actually saddling them with a huge burden and quite likely an impossible demand. Within a marriage, to tell a husband or a wife to forgive and forget when the spouse has been unfaithful, a grievous betrayal has been committed, a sacred trust has been violated. If the marriage meant anything, that sin is going to be hard to be forgiven. To forget is to diminish those marriage vows. The hurt cannot be ignored. The aggrieved has a right to demand, if we like to say, the pound of flesh. He has a right to demand that he or she pay for their betrayal. To tell them to forgive and forget makes a mockery of their marriage vows and belittles the depth of the pain. So what are we going to do? There was ever anyone who had every right in the world to get even, it was the prophet Jeremiah, the one whose words we hear this morning. For chapters, Jeremiah has exposed the sins of the people. He dared to speak against the establishment. He warned of the coming doom because of Israel's unfaithfulness. When God had rescued the people of Israel from bondage in Egypt, God had chosen Israel as his own. At Sinai, God made a wonderful covenant with them, like a groom proposing to a faithful bride. But Israel had been unfaithful, having an affair with the gods of the Canaanites and many others. And God's marriage to Israel was shattered and broken like a clay pot dropped on the ground that now lays in 1,000 pieces. Because Jeremiah had dared to speak like this, his enemies had had him arrested, imprisoned. He was locked in stocks, publicly mocked and brutally beaten. They could not bear to hear the truth of what they had done and what God was going to do to them. Then the Babylonian hordes descended from the north and attacked Jerusalem. They breached the walls of the city. They burned the temple. They captured the king, and along with many of Jeremiah's enemies, led him away in chains to captivity in Babylon. We might say they got what they deserved. Just as we do when we choose to live our lives seeking to get even. You would think that Jeremiah would be delighted with the fate of his persecutors. They got what they deserved for brutally abusing him, but then he did something utterly strange. He took what little money he had left and purchased a piece of land outside Jerusalem. How crazy was that? Everyone else was selling, trying to abandon ship and get far, far away, but Jeremiah did just the opposite. In the midst of the destruction, he bet on the future. He invested in a land that everyone else was abandoning. And then he utters these remarkable words in this passage. In the rubble of Jerusalem, the old covenant of Sinai was shattered. However, Jeremiah promises that God is going to make a new covenant. And in surprising forgiveness of this new covenant, we see a foreshadowing of the same forgiveness that God works in Jesus and continues to work among us today. Even though Jeremiah says God will remember their sin no more, this forgiving is not forgetting. God is not some sleepy old man in the sky, oblivious to our sin. God is not some enabling parent who perpetually overlooks his or her teenager's drunkenness. God is not happy with our sin, our betrayals, or our violence, nor will God just look the other way and pretend that they had never happened. God cannot and does not forget our sin. So God has a dilemma. For God still loves Israel, his chosen. But God also will not be mocked. And Jeremiah knows this and takes dramatic action to resolve this dilemma. Using his own money, buying that piece of land, literally redeeming it from Babylon, he shows his commitment to a new and hopeful future that is being promised. Such a prophetic action demonstrates the essence of the new covenant. For like Jeremiah, God doesn't forget, but remembers sin in a new way. Instead of making us pay, God holds God's tongue. And God surrenders God's right to get a pound of flesh from us. Instead, God pays the price. God sacrifices. God suffers. God bleeds. God redirects God's anger and our sin and God's desire for that pound of flesh upon God's self in the only begotten Son. Jesus is crucified and suffered for what was intended for us. In exchange, we receive Jesus' forgiveness and righteousness. Unlike the old covenant written on tablets of stone so easily broken, this new covenant will be written on people's hearts with two little strokes in the form of a cross marked on our brow. God promises to make God's way into our hearts. Remember, child of God, you have been sealed with the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. Trusting in Christ, we don't have to be reminded to shape up, and secure in Christ, we no longer need to get even. Instead, with a new heart, we seek to live a new life. And each time we confess our sins, that new covenant described by Jeremiah is realized once again. It's like that piece of land Jeremiah bought as a reminder of Israel's end and a new beginning. God remembers our sins. We know them and in faith have courage to name them, but we don't have to pretend that they never happened. Instead, we can hear the glorious good news. God has given God's Son to die for us, and for Christ's sake, He forgives us all our sin. So God in mercy no longer holds that sin against us. And as we believe this amazing promise, everything changes. We break from the same old cycle of revenge, of getting even. Instead, we can partner with God in changing the world. We can forgive those who have wronged us. We don't have to forget what has happened or ignore the injustice done. We just remember the wrongs and injustices in a new way. We don't hold them against those who hurt us. Rather, we join God in breaking that painful and deadly cycle that continues to torment this world. This is similar to what I shared a few weeks ago regarding grace, when I said our word for God's dramatic breaking into our ironclad rules is grace. Grace is God's magnificent release from our self-made prisons, and the only way that God's economy can triumph over our deeply internalized merit badge system. Grace is the secret key whereby God offers to be the divine locksmith for every life and for all of history. Life, when lived fully, tends to tool and retool us until we eventually find some form of grace is necessary for our very survival and sanity. Without grace, almost everything human declines and devolves into smallness, hurt, and blame. Grace humiliates our attempts at private virtue. So as we hear these words of Jesus to his disciples that day, if you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. This is the marvelous word of grace. This word of grace allows us to move beyond forgiving and forgetting. It's the new covenant, a new life that grace makes possible. So joined to God in Christ, we commit ourselves to the care and redemption of all that God has made. And when the world offers us suffering and pain, we will join with Jesus to transform it into goodness and life. Let us pray. Gracious Lord God, we give you thanks for your marvelous gift that we call grace. Touch our hearts and lives, remind us of those marvelous words in our baptism, enable us to truly be those disciples that are able to live out and continue in your word now and as long as we have opportunity. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. My fears relieved.
His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. I invite you to turn to the back of the Celebrate insert where you'll find the prayer petitions of the Church for this day. With confidence in God's grace and mercy, let us pray for the Church, the world, and all those in need.
Renew and inspire the Church in the freedom of the gospel, O God. Where the Church is in error, reform it. Where the Church speaks your truth, strengthen it. Where the Church is divided, unify it. Ignite in us the working of the Holy Spirit. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
As the earth changes, as mountains shake, and the waters roar, may we care for this planet as a holy habitation for all living things. Sustain all peoples and lands recovering from natural disasters of any kind. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide areas of the world divided or traumatized by conflict, especially in our own land. Free all from slavery and human trafficking, and protect all in harm's way. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Release those living in bondage to deaths, chronic pain, or addiction. Grant healing touch to those who are ill, especially all those we hold dear in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
In this family of faith, we give thanks for courageous voices that have remained firm in their commitment to the one who frees us from sin and death. Centered in your grace, unify us in the hope of the gospel. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Even in death, you free us and give us a place in your house. We give thanks for our ancestors who have shown us truth and freedom, especially Martin Luther, and those who work for the renewal of the Church. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Listen as we call on you, O God, and enfold in your loving arms all for whom we pray. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks, he broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks, he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. May the precious body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ strengthen you, keeping you in God's grace now and forever. Amen. He taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Mother in God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you and lead you into the way of truth and life. Amen. Our closing song is, "Lord, keep us steadfast in your word." Safe, and remember one another as you wear your mask.